Hello, everyone. Welcome to your Becker Live Online BEC workshop with Mike Potenza. Thank you for joining us. My name is Angie Jones. I will be the moderator for today's session and will be managing from behind the scenes. Due to the high volume of internet traffic, please be sure to close all other applications on your computer. Items running in the background can drain your bandwidth and cause delays or disruptions in the live stream for you. If you do experience any disruptions, please refresh your browser. That typically solves most issues. Please take a moment and locate your question and answer panel to fully participate. You can see it just below the video panel where you see my photo. As you have questions, please type your question into the Q&A text field and click on the New Question button to submit your question. We have CPA instructors behind the scenes ready to answer in real time. This is a great benefit to our live online format, and we encourage you to use the Q&A feature throughout the session. Once our instructor begins the session and shares their screen, you may need to restore your viewing panels so that you can see everything on your screen. To do this, simply drag screens to move and resize them, or use the Restore button, which is the first icon on the bottom left, to return to the default mode you see now. This session is being recorded and will be made available on demand for you to view at your convenience. The login link to the on-demand recording is the same link you used to join the live stream today. Have a great session with our instructor, Mike Potenza.
Thank you so much, Angie. I just want to share my screen so we can get started. Give me just a second to do that. All right, come on, let's go screen share. Sorry about that. Let me just got to get my menu back here. There it is. And here we go. And we're going to share my entire screen. Hide this and let me switch to my presentation. All right, now we're ready. All right, everybody, I am excited to be here. Listen, we all know we have the same goal here. Pass BEC. We have over 1,000 people here and you all have the same goal, and I'm here to help you achieve that goal. All right. Now we're going to be here. I know we say about an hour and a half. I'm probably saying we're going to be here closer to 2 hours. I have a lot of stuff I want to go over with you. Obviously, I cannot cover everything in all of BEC in just an hour and a half or 2 hours. So what I did is I handpicked some multiple choice questions and some task-based simulations, even a written communication question, to make sure that we could teach you a lot of things. I picked out some questions that come up on the exam very frequently. Then I also picked out a few topics you may not be as familiar with, and I'm going to use these basic questions not just to answer the question, but to really teach you all the different ways they can test this if you see it in another question and they phrase it differently, all right? So we have a lot of multiple choice we want to do. We have a couple of task-based simulations. We're going to do a written communication. Then I'm going to wrap up with timing on the exam. How much time should we spend on a multiple choice question? How much should we spend on task-based simulations and written communications? And then finally, after that, if you have to log off, that's perfectly fine. But we might even do a little contest at the end where you have to answer a few questions, win some, you know, maybe a $50 gift card, a $25 gift card. So if you have time at the end, maybe we'll do something fun like that as well. All right. So again, my name is Mike Potenza. I've been teaching for Becker since 1998. That's before a lot of you were born. So that means a few things. Number one, I'm a super old dude. Yeah, I get it. But at the same time, I have a lot of knowledge about this exam and how to pass this exam. We've helped over 2 million people at Becker pass this exam, and you are going to be the next one to do it. Okay? So I put my little LinkedIn profile there. If you want to connect, you want to send me some questions or give me any kind of feedback, that's always welcome as well. So I want to jump right into things, and let's do our first multiple choice question. Okay? Now, this question says, the Committee on Sponsoring Organizations, better known as COSA, right? They have an internal control integrated framework, which is really the guide for establishing internal control frameworks within an organization. Now, part of that includes a risk assessment component that includes all of the following except what. So reading comprehension here, they're telling us, listen, 3 out of the 4 are part of COSO, 1 is not. Which one is that? Before we even answer that question, let's talk about the internal control integrated framework from COSO. There are 5 components to it, all right? We use the acronym CRIME. We say it's a crime if you don't have good internal control. The C stands for the control environment, which is really established by the people at the top of the organization, the CEO, the CFO. We call it setting the tone at the top. And there are five items within the control environment you should be aware of. And we have an acronym to remember that, EBOCA. Now, EBOCA is not a real word, but I love to say it. It's fun to say EBOCA, right? EBOCA. I'm going to go over what that means in just a moment. Then we have the R in the crime acronym, risk assessment, because we have a risk that our financial statements may be materially misstated or even worse, may be fraudulent. And there are four components that make up the risk assessment. We use an acronym SAFER, right? It's safer to make sure you do a risk assessment and there's no fraud, right? SAFER. Then we have the I, which is pretty straightforward, information and communication. We need to share necessary information in a timely manner and share accurate information, whether it's internal management reports, external financial statements. We have to share accurate and timely information. Now, monitoring is a big part of controls because we set up controls, but we can't just set them up and walk away. We have to make sure we watch over these controls and they're doing what they were designed to do. They're working properly, all right? So that's part of the internal control framework, monitoring controls. And finally, the E in the crime acronym stands for existing control activities. In our organization, we're going to have existing internal control policies and procedures. Someone has to watch over these, and you know, different people do it for different divisions and different departments, but we have to make sure they're documented and that they are adhered to. Okay? So these are the five main components of internal control. Now, let's talk about this EBOCA, the five items that make up the control environment. Ethics. It's up to the people at the top of the organization where they set the tone at the top, the CEO, the CFO, the CIO, all of our other officers. They act in an ethical manner and they make sure the company works and operates ethically. That's part of your control environment. Then the B is board oversight. The board of directors appoints officers. They cannot just appoint officers and then not watch over them. They have to actively monitor and watch over the officers they appoint and make sure that they are complying with the policies, the procedures, the vision statement, the mission, and adding value to the organization. Then we have the O. Every organization has to have an organizational structure, which is nothing more than a fancy way to say an org chart. Who runs it? Who's the CEO? Who's the CFO? Who are all the other officers? Who are their managers that report to them? And then who reports to those managers? So you need to have an established chain of authority, okay? An organizational chart. Now you need a commitment to competence, the C in EBOCA. In other words, you have to make sure everyone that you hire is competent to do their job. And they're committed to doing their job. They show up. They do things in a professional manner. There must be a commitment to competence and accountability. If something goes wrong, whose fault is it? Why did it go wrong? All right. We have to hold people accountable. So those are the five items of EBOCA that make up the control environment where we set the tone at the top. Now, SAFER. These are the four components of risk assessment. In order to do a risk assessment, you need to understand the organizational objectives. What does the organization want to accomplish? What are their objectives? How do they relate to the financial statements? And then look closely at your internal controls. Have there been any changes to the internal controls recently? You have to assess changes. Why? Were these changes authorized? Did someone change the internal controls so they can circumvent it to commit fraud or steal from the organization? Then consider the potential for fraud. Is there anyone in the organization that for some reason may want to rob or steal or cheat the organization? Are there disgruntled employees? Have they authorized changes to internal control? If so, why? And finally, perform this overall risk analysis of the organization and how it relates to the financial statements. And is it possible there could be material misstatements or fraud due to any, you know, evidence that was discovered? All right. So SAFER. Remember, you do a risk assessment, it will be safer for your organization and for your financial statements. All right. Now that I've laid out everything you need to know about internal control integrated framework, let's get back to this question. What are they asking us? They want us to do a risk assessment. So that means they're specifically asking us about the SAFER acronym. They say everything in the risk assessment listed A, B, C, and D is part of risk assessment except what? Except which one? So let's go through it. First thing we have is S, specify organizational objectives. Look at letter A. By definition, it's right there. So that is part of the risk assessment, part of the SAFER acronym, so that's not a good answer. Assess changes to internal control. Yes, that's part of risk assessment as well, so that's not a good answer. Consider the potential for fraud. That's part of risk assessment, so that's not a good answer. Then you see organizational structure, and oh yeah, that's part of EBOCA, which is part of the control environment, not part of the risk assessment. Therefore, that is the correct answer. So you can see there's so many different ways they can test this. So this is just the internal control integrated framework. Remember, COSO also has ERM, Enterprise of Risk Management, right? Now, we're not going to go over that in this. We just don't have time, but it's just like this. These are all word games, all right? It's all memorization. And when you see a question, when you see a component of either internal controls or enterprise risk framework, you need to make sure you could play the word game and know where does it come from within the framework, all right? And the only way to do that is to study, do a lot of practice questions, and try to memorize where you can. Next question. Which of the following is true of audit committees under SOX, under good old Sarbanes-Oxley? So it's an audit committee question. Before I even look at the answers and try to find a true statement, let's review Sarbanes-Oxley. Let's review the audit committee. So under Sarbanes-Oxley, you need to have an audit committee, and people have to make up that audit committee. So who are these people that can make it up? It has to be members of your board of directors, all right? Only members of the board can be on the audit committee. And not just any board of director member can be there. You must be independent. What does that mean if you want to be independent? It means as someone on the audit committee, you cannot accept any compensation for consulting or advisory services for the organization outside of any salary you receive for being a member of the board. That's okay. But no additional compensation for anything else. Otherwise, that's fine. You could do it, but you're not independent and you cannot be on the audit committee. As well as you cannot be an affiliated person of the issuer. What does that mean, an affiliated person? It means you have the ability to affect financial decisions of the organization. For example, the CEO might be on the board of directors, but the CEO is affiliated to the organization and can make everyday business decisions that financially affect the company. Therefore, they cannot be on the audit committee. All right. Now, also on the audit committee, you must have at least one financial expert. Now, what does that mean to be a financial expert? Well, basically, you can qualify as a financial expert through education. It doesn't mean you have to be a CPA. It would be great if you were, that would help, but you don't have to be. But you have to show an education in accounting and in other related financial topics, as well as experience. Now, if you're a CPA, public accountant, that's great. Maybe you were a principal accountant or a financial officer for a public company. That's all great experience. And as a financial expert, you should also demonstrate that you have an understanding of GAAP, how to apply GAAP, as well as experience preparing and auditing financial statements, having experience with internal controls, as well as understanding functions of the audit committee. So these are all different things that apply to a financial expert. Now, this multiple choice question is really a straightforward question, but just based on the information I've shared with you, you can see how they could really dive much more deeply into the audit committee than just what this question does, all right? So again, this question says, which of the following is true of an audit committee under the provision of SOX? Well, choice A says a majority of the audit committee must be financial experts. No, it's only one. Technically, you only need one. Letter B, no financial experts are required. Well, that's no good, right? That's no good. You need at least one. Letter C, at least one audit committee member must be a financial expert. Absolutely true by definition. So that is a good answer. Then it says at least two must be all financial experts. No. And one must be a CPA. No, no such rules. Okay. So the only correct answer here, choice C. All right, next one. Which of the following statements will result in a decrease in price? And if you look at your choices, it's all about supply. It's all about demand. Now, you will see supply and demand on the exam. And I'm going to show you with this question how simple supply and demand is. So if you give me a few minutes to go through this, you're going to be like, oh, wow, I get this. This is easy. Maybe you already get it. But if you don't, this is really going to help you out, okay? So
They're asking us what's going to result when there's a decrease in price. So I'm going to abbreviate price with the letter P, and I'm going to use a down arrow for a decrease. I'll use an up arrow for an increase, a down arrow for a decrease. So supply and demand on the BEC exam under economics can be tested in four different ways. The first thing they can do is give you a question where demand decreases, all right, D with the down arrow. But they could do the opposite. They could give you a question where demand increases. They can give you a question where supply decreases, or they can give you a question where supply increases, or they can combine them, all right? Right now, we're going to take each one at a time and make sure you understand what happens if demand goes up or demand goes down, or supply goes up or supply goes down. And we're thinking about this from a specific product right now, all right? Think about a company that sells a product, and the demand for that product might go up. The demand for that product might go down. The supply might go up, the supply might go down. We have to understand if demand or supply goes up or down, what effect does that have on the quantity of product a company wants to produce? And what effect does that have on the price they're willing to sell that product, all right? So supply and demand affects quantity produced and price sold. So here is a graph. Now in this graph, you can see this is what we're going to call a shift left. Why do I call it a shift left? We're starting at the purple curve to the right, letter D, and we're shifting left to D1. A shift left is a decrease, all right? So anytime we shift left, there's a decrease. And since we're shifting the demand curve left, we show a decrease in demand. So if demand goes down, what's going to happen if demand, and you know what? I just skipped over one other thing. Assume for this question, for this demonstration right now, supply is constant. That's why the supply curve is not moving. All right. So let's shift demand and hold supply constant. So if demand goes down, what effect does that have on the quantity we want to produce? Just think about this from a common sense point of view right now. If you're a company and you're selling a product and all of a sudden nobody wants to buy that product, the demand goes down. Do you want to produce more of that product or less of that product? Obviously less because there's no demand for it. So look at the bottom center of this. You see that graph Q and Q1? Notice when we shift from D to D1, we shift left. What happens to the quantity produced? It goes from Q to Q1. In other words, because there's a decrease in demand, we're going to produce less. The quantity goes down as well. How about price? If you're selling a product, and the demand goes down and you want to sell more of it, but there's not as much demand, what are you going to do? Are you going to raise the price or are you going to lower the price? Obviously, you're going to lower the price, and we see it. Price is going to fall from P to P1 because we can't raise the price if there's lower demand. If there's less demand, how are you going to raise the price? Nobody's going to buy it, right? So that's why we have to lower the price. So notice what's happening here that I just wrote. If demand goes down, quantity goes down, and price goes down. All three arrows move in the same direction. We call that being directly correlated, all right? They're directly correlated. Now, let's do the opposite. Let's shift right. Let's increase demand. It's equal and opposite. If we start at D1 and we shift right to D, what's going to happen? Well, if we increase demand, guess what happens? Hey, everybody wants to buy our product. Let's produce more because we'll be able to sell more. So quantity will increase from Q1 to Q. And what about price? Well, if people want to buy our products, what are we going to do? Raise the price. They'll be willing to pay a little bit more. So price is going to rise from P1 to P. Price will increase as well. So notice equal and opposite. In scenario one, if demand goes down, quantity goes down, price goes down. But in scenario two, if demand goes up, quantity goes up, price goes up. You must memorize these. You will see these on the exam in some way, shape, or form. All right? Please memorize them. Now let's talk about supply. What we're going to do here is leave demand constant for now and just shift supply. We're going to start out with decreasing supply. So we're going to shift left. Remember, anytime it's a shift left, it's a decrease. If it's a shift right, it's an increase. So we're shifting left from S to S1. So for whatever reason, now forget about demand. Demand stays the same. Demand's not changing. But for whatever reason, we have less supply of a product to sell. So if we have less supply of a product to sell, what does that mean about the quantity of product? Did we produce more or less? Obviously, if supplies are down, we're producing less products. We don't have enough raw materials. We don't have enough supply, right? So what's going to happen if supply goes down, Q is going to decrease from Q to Q1 because if we don't have the supplies, we cannot produce the products, right? They're directly correlated. But what about price? If demand is constant, but we have less product to sell, but people still want the product, we just don't have as much, what do we do to the price? You got it. We raise it. Notice it increases from P to P1. This is our first inverse relationship, okay? Notice on the left-hand side of my screen, everything for demand going up and down is directly correlated. All the arrows move in the same direction. That is not true for supply, okay? If supply goes down, we produce less quantity, but we raise the price. Now, the equal and opposite is true if we increase supply, if we shift right, okay? If we shift right, if we increase our supply level, that means we can produce more goods, right? So what's going to happen is our quantity is going to increase from Q1 to Q. We produce more. We have more raw materials. We could produce more supply. But now, if the demand stays the same, but we're producing a lot more quantity of goods than we've done in the past, but the demand doesn't increase, how do we get rid of all of that extra quantity of goods we produced without any new demand? Well, we have to lower the price. Notice P will drop from P1 to P. Again, inverse relationship. So notice there's a directly correlated relationship between supply level and quantity, but an inverse relationship to price. You must memorize these as well. So I'm giving you four. I'm giving you four relationships, and I'm asking you, please, you want to pass this exam, memorize these four. Now, let me put the demand and the supply all together so that we have it in one place. All right. You need to memorize these four. Now, let's get back to our question. Our question asks, which of the following statements will result in a decrease in price? P with the down arrow. Well, here's P with the down arrow. If demand decreases, I know price decreases. But notice there's also another P when supplies go up and we produce more, right? So if I'm looking for a scenario where price drops, this is how easy the question is. I just need to look for a decrease in demand or an increase in supply. It's that simple, okay? So let's go to choice A. A decrease in supply, assuming demand remains constant. Well, what did we say about supply? It's not a decrease in supply. It's an increase in supply. So this is wrong. What about the next one? A decrease in supply? No, it's not a decrease in supply. And then it says, assuming an increase in demand, it's the opposite. It's not an increase in demand. It's a decrease in demand. So that's wrong as well. Letter C, an increase in demand? No, it's not an increase in demand. It's a decrease in demand. So the only correct answer, choice D, a decrease in demand? Yes, assuming supply remains constant? Sure. Or it could be an increase in supply, assuming demand remains constant. Or it could be a decrease in demand and an increase in supply. If it said both of those, it would still be a good answer. So the only correct answer here, my friends, choice D. All right. This is great stuff. You love BEC. I know you're doing. You're going to love it even more when you pass BEC. All right. Believe me. And we're going to do it. We're going to pass it. Next one. Let's talk about the money supply. If there's a decrease in the money supply, what could cause that? I'm going to abbreviate money supply MS. Okay. Money supply. Now, what is the money supply? Who controls the money supply, right? Say, hey, I love a little more money supply, right? Can I get a little more of that? Well, that's why you want to pass the exam and become a CPA, because your money supply from your salary, from when you're a partner or where you're a CEO or a CFO, is going to become much larger, all right? I promise you, money supply is a good thing. So money supply is controlled through monetary policy. Now, monetary policy consists of tools used by the bank of the federal government. We call the Federal Reserve, also known as the Fed. And they use the money supply. They control the money supply to stabilize the economy, all right? Now, there are three tools that the Fed has available in order to do this. The first one is known as open market operations, or we abbreviate OMO. And what the Fed can do is they can purchase or sell government securities, usually with the Treasury Department. We'll talk about that in just a moment. The second tool they have is the discount rate, also abbreviated DR for discount rate, which is nothing more than controlling the interest rate, right? We lived through all-time lows over the last decade of the lowest interest there's ever been in this country. And now in the last couple of years, it's come back again because they had to stabilize the economy, try to control inflation. And then there's the required reserve ratio, or the RRR, which is the percentage of all deposits that banks are required to hold within their walls, hold in their vault. Because every time people make deposits in a bank can't take all that money and just reinvest it all. They have to leave a certain amount of money in the bank, and the Federal Reserve tells them what that percentage of deposits is, and they can control that. All right. So these are the three tools I'm going to ask you to remember, but let me explain how the Federal Reserve uses them. All right. First one is OMO, and you're going to need to memorize this as well. Open market operations. Two things can happen here. Either the Federal Reserve can purchase government securities, usually from the Treasury Department. In other words, they say to the Treasury, hey, here's a bunch of money. We want to buy your government securities. So if the Federal Reserve purchases government securities, they're giving the government a lot of money to spend. Therefore, they're increasing the money supply and the government can spend more money. But the opposite is true if the Fed sells back the government securities to the government. In other words, they say, hey, here are all the securities we bought from you. We're selling them back to you. Take back the securities. Give us our money back. They're taking money away from the government, so they're decreasing the money supply. So you have to memorize this. When they purchase government securities, they increase the money supply. When they sell back the government securities, they take the money back, they decrease the money supply. The discount rate is the interest rate. Now, if the Federal Reserve raises the discount rate, in essence, what they're doing is they're raising the interest rate on all banks. And what happens when the interest rate goes up? Do people borrow more or less money? They borrow less money. So if people are borrowing less money, there's less money in circulation. Therefore, the money supply decreases. Okay. So there's an inverse relationship between the interest rates and the money supply. The opposite is true when the Federal Reserve lowers the discount rate. They lower the interest rate. People are like, oh wow, the interest rate's so low, I want to borrow more money. So there's more money in circulation, and that increases the money supply. Then finally, the required reserve ratio. This is how much of deposits banks must hold in their vault. So if the Federal Reserve raises the required reserve ratio, they tell banks they have to hold more money within their vaults. There's less money for banks to reinvest into the economy. Therefore, it decreases the money supply. So there's an inverse relationship between the required reserve ratio and the money supply. The opposite is true when the Fed decreases the required reserve ratio. They tell banks they could reinvest more of the money deposited. That will increase the money supply. Okay? Now, this question is all about decreasing the money supply, right? So I highlighted in yellow the three tools the Federal Reserve has if they want to decrease the money supply. So this question is as simple as finding one of these items highlighted in yellow, all right? So I just drew some little arrows here. So you see if the money supply goes down, these are the three tools that we are going to use, okay? All right, so letter A, increasing the required reserve ratio. That decreases the money supply. Is that what we want to do? Absolutely yes. This is the correct answer. Increasing the required reserve ratio decreases the money supply. See, there's an inverse relationship here, right? Increase required reserve ratio decreases the money supply. They wanted to test you to see if you knew it was an inverse relationship. Letter B, decreasing the RRR? No, that's the opposite. That will increase the money supply, but this question asks about decreasing the money supply. Purchasing government securities? In this situation, that will increase the money supply, right? And this question asks about decreasing the money supply. So that's not right. And finally, letter D, decreasing the discount rate will increase the money supply. And we're looking for a decrease in money supply. So the only correct answer here, choice A. All right. We're rocking and rolling. I hope you learned a few things right now you can learn on the test, right? I hate for you to come here and hang out with these thousand other people and be like, I already knew that, right? So hopefully this helped you out a bit. Or maybe it just reinforced stuff you already know and didn't remember, right? But it's all stuff you're going to see on the exam, my friends. So let's do the next one now. Also on the Federal Reserve, here's a different way. The first question we did just before this, it was a decrease in money supply. This is an increase in money supply. How could we do it? Well, now to increase the money supply, again, purchase government securities, lower the discount rate, lower the required reserve ratio. That's it. So I have to find one of those three. Increase the required reserve ratio? No, that is the opposite of what we want to do. Decreasing the discount rate is good, but it wouldn't be an increase to the required reserve ratio, a decrease. So that's no good. Decrease the discount rate? Yes. Purchase government securities? Yes. Both of those, my friends, increase the money supply. So that's a good answer. Letter C, decrease the required reserve ratio? Yes. Sell government securities? No. Purchase government securities. So that would be wrong. And letter D, increase the discount rate? No, decrease the discount rate. Purchase government securities, yes, but decrease the discount rate. So only correct answer here, just to show you a different way they can test it, choice B. All right. Oligopoly. That's always a fancy word to say, oligopoly, right? What is an oligopoly? And it's characterized by what? Well, before I even go over anything about this question, let's review the four different market structures that are testable on the exam. Because if you're running a business, your business is going to fall into one of these four market structures. And I'm going to explain what they are, give you examples, and highlight the most important points of each of these four market structures. First off is what we call a market structure known as perfect or pure competition. Think about selling a bottle of water. Bottle of water, anybody can get their hands on a bottling machine. Anybody can get their hands on water, right? It's not hard to do. So what do we need to know about it? There are so many different companies that sell bottled water, right? They sell very similar, if not identical products, okay? And there are no barriers to entry because everyone can get these materials. There's no product differentiation. I'm not talking about vitamin water or, you know, any of these fancy waters that I can't afford to buy, all right? It's like $6 a bottle of water. I'm like, what? I'm talking about your regular H2O, right? Your regular water costs, you know, $1.50, $2 for a nice bottle of water. No product differentiation. We call anyone that operates under perfect or pure competition a price taker. Because if you're in, let's call it a city or a neighborhood, and all the stores sell a bottle of water for $2, and you say, oh, I'm going to sell mine for $3, nobody's going to buy it. You have to take the price the market gives you, okay? Price takers. And under what we call perfect competition, there is perfect elasticity. Demand is perfectly elastic. Basically, what that means is as you raise your price, any amount, you are going to lose demand, all right? There's nothing you can do about it. You raise your price, you lose demand. Now, look at choice C, homogeneous products sold by a large number of sellers. By definition, that is what we just went over, perfect competition. And that has nothing to do with an oligopoly, so it's not a good answer. Second one, monopolistic competition. And I love to use the example coffee, right? Some people like Starbucks, some like Dunkin' Donuts, some like Pete's Coffee, whatever it is you like. But the difference is this. You know, you could go to a diner and get a basic cup of coffee probably for $2, or I could go to Starbucks and get a mocha frappuccino pumpkin spice latte with whipped cream. And all of a sudden I have a meal in front of me. It's like $5 or $6. You're like, wow, that's pretty expensive. But people buy it. Why? Because there's some differentiation. There's brand awareness. There's loyalty. There's advertising, right? So monopolistic competition where there's a lot of companies selling like coffee, you know, similar products, but they do somewhat differentiate the products, okay? And there's not a lot of barriers to entry. It's not that hard to get your hands on coffee beans and sell coffee, but they do it with a little product differentiation. And they do have some influence over price because of that brand awareness, because of that loyalty, because of that advertising. For whatever reason, people think, oh, I'm a Starbucks person, or I'm a Pete's person, or I'm a Dunkin' Donuts person. I need that coffee. And as they raise the price, people still buy it because they don't want to go to one of the others, even if it's a little difference in price, because they really feel like they like the taste of one product better than the other, right? That's monopolistic competition. Here, demand is still elastic. It's not as elastic as perfect competition, but it is elastic. Look at letter D, differentiated products sold by a large numbers of sellers. By definition, that is our monopolistic competition, which is not an oligopoly. Number three, here we go. Let's talk about oligopoly, like American car, it says dealers, it should say manufacturers, American car dealers or manufacturers. There's only three. There's only three companies. Other people wanted to try. It didn't work out. It's not easy to do. All right. An oligopoly is a structure where you have a very small number of sellers in a market and they dominate the sales in that market. These different sellers, like the three American car manufacturers, they sell similar but differentiated products, and they have to be able to control the price that they charge for a vehicle, the quantity that they produce in order to be competitive. And there are huge, there are significant barriers to entry. You think it's easy to say, I'm going to be the fourth American manufacturer of automobiles. Yeah, if you do, if you have a couple, you know, maybe 20, 30, 40, $50 billion stashed away somewhere, because you have to come up with designs, you have to come up with the manufacturing plants, you have to come up with testing, you have to come up with insurance, forget about it, right? It's almost impossible. Huge barriers to entry. And here's one of the things that stands out about an oligopoly. They test numerous times. An oligopoly is the only one of the four market structures that has a kinked or a broken demand curve. And the reason it's kinked or broken is because if one of these car manufacturers raises their price above equilibrium, the other manufacturers don't follow suit. But if they lower their product below equilibrium, below the average price, and put it on sale, the others have to do so. So it creates two different slopes in the demand curve, one above the equilibrium, one below the equilibrium, and it breaks the curve. I'm going to show you what it looks like. Here's what it looks like. Look right at this center point. This is your what we call the equilibrium price, or you know, your average price, we'll call it. Okay. Now, if one manufacturer raises their price above equilibrium, notice the slope is not as steep. It gets a little flatter because there's not as much demand when they raise their price, and the other manufacturers will not follow suit and raise their price. So it lowers the slope of the demand curve above the equilibrium price. But now look at the slope below the equilibrium price. If they put it on sale, all right, if they lower their price, the other firms in the oligopoly have to lower their price or they'll lose too much business, and it increases the demand, which a much steeper slope. So that's the kinked, the broken demand curve, when you change the price to either above or below equilibrium. All right, so now take a look at choice A, differentiated products produced by a small number of sellers. That, my friends, is a definition of oligopoly, and that is the correct answer here. Finally, the fourth market structure is a monopoly. We're familiar with monopoly when only one company has the right to sell a product. Now, we know antitrust laws are in place, monopolies are legal, but you can think about a monopoly on a small scale. What if a company invents a patent and they have the only right to sell that product? Well, they basically have a monopoly for a certain amount of time on that product. They're the only one that can sell it, all right? So you have a single seller with the ability to sell a unique product, and there are insurmountable barriers of entry. You cannot sell this product because you don't have the legal right to sell this product, right? If someone else owns the patents. So we call anyone that operates under a monopoly in this way, under a patent, price setters. They can charge whatever they want. And you've heard the term like price gouging, right? Things like that. So they have to be careful not to be obscene with it, but technically they can charge whatever price they want. And here, demand is perfectly inelastic, meaning they don't care what you raise the price if it's inelastic. Whatever you charge, if people need it, they have to pay it because there's nowhere else for them to go. I want you to look and compare perfect or pure competition to monopoly. Perfect competition is known as a price taker, where demand is perfectly elastic. Monopoly is a price setter, where demand is perfectly inelastic. These two are opposites, okay? So watch out for that. You never know when that comes up. Choice B, a product sold by one seller. Yes, my friends, that is a monopoly, and they're asking about oligopoly here, so that is a wrong answer. The only correct answer, choice A. All right, still moving and grooving, rocking and rolling. Next one up, similar concept. This is about a gourmet coffee company, and they recently increased their price. So they said, you know what? We're going to charge more money for our coffee, okay? Well, what happened? As a result of that price increase, guess what? They, experienced a large reduction in total revenue. So you raise your price because you think you want to generate more revenue, right? But a lot of times it's an inverse relationship. Why? Well, let's talk about that. Price goes up, but total revenue went down. Why is that? Well, here's what we can conclude about the demand based on that. The way you calculate your revenue for a particular product, what's the price you charge for that product multiplied by the quantity of the product sold? Simple math, okay? So here's a table right out of our textbook. And notice in this table, the third column. Well, the first column has price elasticity of demand. What's elastic, what's inelastic, what's unit elastic, all right? And implied elasticity tells you, if you mathematically calculate, which we're not going to do, we don't have enough time to do that right now, but you could mathematically calculate based on the initial price and the new price and the initial quantity demanded and the new quantity demanded, you can figure out the elasticity through a calculation and come up with a number. If the number is greater than one, it's price elastic, meaning, uh-oh, if I raise my price too much, I'm going to lose more demand. If it's less than one, it's inelastic. So even though you raised your price, you didn't lose that much demand. And unit elastic means for every percent you raise the price, you lose the exact same percent of quantity demanded. So it's like a one-to-one. Raise it 5%, lose 5% of the demand. Raise it 10%, lose 10%. That's unit elasticity. So we're in a situation where we raised the price, and what happened? Total revenue went down. So think about it. Total revenue, you see that down arrow? That went down. But price went up. Notice my price going up is a small arrow, which must mean my quantity sold went down, right? Elasticity means if a product is elastic, let's say I raise it, my price 10%, I'm losing a greater amount of quantity sold, maybe 20%. So what we say is the price increase was more than offset by the decrease in quantity demanded and ultimately the quantity sold. So although I raised my price a certain percentage, I lost a greater percentage of the quantity sold. Therefore, the total revenue is down. All right. So we have to watch out for that. And that means we are in an elastic environment. All right. This product sales is elastic. So if I take a look at this, the only choice here that says, hey, this demand is price elastic, choice A. And that's our correct answer for this question. All right, let's move on to the next question. Now, this question has more than three lines. That's four more lines. Anytime that happens, I like to start reading the last sentence first, because before I start reading it, I want to know what they're asking me. It says, if the company's current debt to equity ratio is 0.25 and their total debt ratio is 0.2, what is the minimum hurdle rate Expansion Inc. will use? You go, oh, hurdle rate question. And how do you have to do with, you know, certain capital investments, things like that? Well, what do we need to know about the hurdle rate for this exam? Well, we have something called WACC. WACC stands for weighted average cost of capital, right? If you want to run your business, you need capital to run your business. So there's a cost to capital, and that cost is known as WACC. It's your weighted average cost of capital, right? And we use that to calculate the hurdle rate. And the hurdle rate we could use to assess capital investments. You know, you could use it when you're calculating net present value, internal rate of returns, things like that, all right? So let's talk about reading comprehension. When I read this and it asks me, what is my minimum hurdle rate? What are they really asking me here? They're asking me, hey, based on the information we provided, can you calculate WACC? Because if you calculate WACC, that's normally what we use for the hurdle rate. So they're just asking, can you calculate WACC? That's it. All right, that's it. Okay, let's read the facts. Expansion Inc. is looking for a number of capital projects and is trying to determine the appropriate hurdle rate to use to ensure improvement of shareholder value, right? That's their job, to add value to a company. Now it starts to get into the information we need. The company's after-tax cost of debt is 7%, and it's reliably computed that the cost of equity financing is 12%. See, when you raise capital, you're going to raise it through a combination of debt and equity financing. And we take a weighted average of the debt and equity financing to calculate WACC, all right? It's that simple. So here's our formula to calculate WACC. It's your percentage of capital acquired through debt multiplied by your after-tax cost of debt. Then you add that to your percentage of capital raised through equity financing multiplied by your cost of equity, all right? That's it. So now we have to find these four numbers and plug them into the formula. So first number I see is my after-tax cost of debt of 7%. So I'm going to take that 7% and I'm going to plug it into this area where it says after-tax cost of debt. That's going to become 7%. But this was kind of an easier question because they gave you the after-tax cost of debt. Sometimes they don't do that. Sometimes they give you the pre-tax cost of debt, or they'll just refer to as the interest rate. And if they give you the interest rate, you have to convert it from a pre-tax cost of debt to an after-tax cost of debt. An extra step is involved. So we don't have to do it in this question, but I want to show you how to do it in case you get it on the exam. All right? So look at this note in the bottom left corner. They gave us the after-tax cost of debt. But what happens if they gave us the pre-tax cost of debt, which AKA also known as the interest rate? What you would have to do is convert this pre-tax cost of debt, the interest rate, to the after-tax cost of debt. How? How do you do that? Really super simple. All you need to do to calculate the after-tax cost of debt, you take your interest rate, the pre-tax cost of debt, and you multiply it by 1 minus the tax rate. Now, they didn't even give us the tax rate in this question because they didn't give us the pre-tax cost or the interest rate, so we don't have to worry about it. But that formula you need to know at the very bottom of the screen, your after-tax cost of debt is your interest rate times 1 minus your tax rate, okay? All right, back to this question at hand. Okay, here is our cost of equity, 12%. So I know my after-tax cost of debt is 7%. I know my cost of equity is 12%. So now we have to figure out what's our percentage of capital through debt, what's our percentage of capital through equity. How do we do that? How do we calculate percent debt and percent equity? They gave us the financial ratios to do it, all right? So you see it says total debt ratio is 0.2. It's saying your total debt ratio is 0.2 of all of your capital, all right? That's all they're saying. So really, when they tell you your total debt ratio is 0.2, they're telling you your percentage of debt is 20%. It's that simple. And if my debt is 20%, what's my equity? Well, if debt's 20%, your equity has to be 80% because the two added together have to equal 100%, all right? It's not hard math. It's not hard math. And if you don't believe me, you can double check. Look at the debt to equity ratio they gave us, 0.25. You don't need to do this, but you could say, well, my numerator in my debt to equity is going to be debt. My denominator is equity. My debt is 0.2. My equity, I'm saying, is 0.8. What's 0.2 divided by 0.8? 0.25. That's my debt to equity ratio, right? So it all calculates. It all matches up. So I know now my percent debt is 20%. My percent equity is 80%. Let's do the math, all right? I plug in 20% for my percent debt. I plug in 7% for my after-tax cost of debt. Then I add that to my 80% of equity multiplied by my 12% cost of equity. Do the math. 11%. Look for an answer. Hopefully it's there. Bingo, right there. And my friends, we are done. Not a difficult question if you understand the WACC formula and the reading comprehension. Half the battle to get these questions right, reading comprehension, understanding what they are asking you. And that's why I handpicked a lot of these questions, because they, although are simple on the back end, a little tricky on the front end going through the reading comprehension. All right, got more good stuff coming. All right. Uh-oh. Variance analysis, everybody's favorite topic, right? You're like, oh no, do we have to do this? What was the material price variance for May 1? That's what they're asking. Okay, well, to do variance analysis questions, we have to understand sometimes a variance analysis may be related to direct materials. Sometimes it may be related to direct labor, okay? Now, we have two different direct material equations I want you to memorize, and we have two different direct labor equations I want you to memorize. Right out of our textbook, here's the four equations you need to memorize for this, okay? And we have a little acronym to do it. First equation is price variance, which relates to direct material, all right? And we use a P in the acronym for this. Then we have direct quantity usage, also a direct material equation. So we're assessing usage, so we're going to use a U. Then we have our two direct labor equations. We have direct labor rate variance, so we use an R. And then finally, we have direct labor efficiency variance, we use an E. So our acronym is PURE. Our four variance analysis equations for direct material and direct labor, PURE. And you have to memorize them. Now, price variance analysis, you take the actual quantity used and you multiply it by the difference between the actual and the standard price, all right? So notice in parentheses, we take the difference of the price. What's the name of this equation? Price. So whatever the name of the equation is usually what you're subtracting in parentheses, all right? Same thing is true for usage. You take your standard price, but in parentheses, you multiply it by the difference in usage. What you actually use minus what you should have used, your standard quantity allowed, what you should have used. For rate variance, you multiply the actual hours worked by the difference between the actual rate and the standard rate. And then finally, your direct labor efficiency variance, you take your standard rate and you multiply it by the hours worked minus the hours that should have been worked, right? The hours that you allowed them to work. And that's how you come up with these numbers. So you have to know these four. Now, one other thing that comes into play in these equations is whether a number you calculate is favorable variance or unfavorable variance. We know something is favorable variance if the actual cost or the actual quantity used is less than what you should have used, less than the standard cost or less than the standard quantity that was allowed. If that's the case, it's a favorable result. You did it for less money. The opposite is true if your actual cost or your, you know, quantity used is greater than your standard cost or your allowable quantity used. Uh-oh, it cost us too much money, or uh-oh, we used too many raw materials. That is unfavorable, all right? So it's key to know, is it favorable or unfavorable? Okay, this question is asking about material price variance. So that's going to be the P of these four equations in the PURE acronym, the direct material price variance. So here's what we need to know. All right, I'm going to rewrite this equation. All right, this equation highlighted in yellow, direct material price variance is going to be equal to the actual quantity purchased multiplied by the difference between the actual price and the standard price. So I need to find those variables in the given information. So let's go and read the question. Flatbush Corp has a standard costing system for each product. Great. Now the standard, here's my standard information, important. Standard direct material cost to produce a unit of its premier product, Brook, for is 4 pounds of material at $2.50 a pound for $10 a unit. See, what I'm gonna be interested in this is the raw material, the pounds of the material, which is $2.50 a pound. All right, so they're trying to confuse me by throwing in 4 pounds of material needed, $10 a unit. No, they're asking about the material price variance. So that's why the $2.50, the price for the material, is the key, okay? Then during May year one, 8,400 pounds of the material was purchased, which cost $20,160, all right? That's what we purchased, and they produced 2,000 units. Well, I don't care about producing the 2,000 units. I need to compare my actual material cost to my standard cost. So can I tell what is my actual material cost? Not yet, because they just gave me the bulk of the material purchased and the overall price. So they give us 8,400 pounds purchased and we spent $20,160, but they didn't give us the actual cost per unit for the material. So we have to calculate the actual price per pound. Really easy. To get the actual price, you just take your total price, divide it by all the pounds purchased, and you come up with the number. So we spent in total $20,160 on 8,400 pounds. So now we see, oh, the actual price per unit or per unit of material is $2.40. So let's take that $2.40 and plug it into the actual price. So now I have my direct material variance is 8,400 pounds, right? That's how much we purchased, times the actual price, $2.40, minus the standard price, $2.50, okay? If you do the math on that, you come out with direct material price variance of $840, and it's favorable. Why is it favorable? Because the actual cost of $240 is less than the standard cost of $250. So anytime my cost is less than my standard cost, hey, that's good news. I spent less money, so that is favorable. So I have $840 favorable. See choice B, list $840 favorable. And my friends, we are done with this question. All right, almost done with MCQs. Just a few more. Really good one right here. A comparison of absorption costing versus direct costing method yields what? All right, before I get into the details, let's pull up an item, a table that I love right from our textbook. Now, They show side by side absorption costing and variable costing, also known as direct costing. What's the difference between them? Why do we need two different costing mechanisms? Well, absorption is what you use when you study financial accounting, right? Because it's GAAP. So anytime for financial statement purposes that are going to be used for the general public under financial accounting rules, we use absorption costing because it's GAAP. Now, variable or direct costing, is not GAAP. You go, not GAAP. Can we use it? You bet we can. What do we use it for? Internal management decisions, all right? Running our business, running our operations, all right? So it's a separate costing mechanism to give us a better understanding internally of what's going on within our organization. But for public-facing financial statements, we have to use absorption costing. So what's the similarities and differences between them? Good news is they're almost identical. They're identical with only one difference, and you must know that difference, okay? So under absorption costing, we have product costs and period costs. Same thing is true for variable costing. We have product costs and period costs. What are product costs? Product costs are costs that live on our balance sheet, and they're contained as an asset in inventory until the finished goods are sold. That's true for absorption costing. That's true for variable costing. All right. Notice this is the same for all three. Under both methods, direct materials, direct labor, and variable manufacturing overhead are all considered product costs and live in the inventory on our balance sheet as an asset until the goods are sold. You cannot expense them until the goods are sold. They do not hit your income statement until the goods are sold. Now let's talk about period costs. Period costs are immediately expensed and hit your income statement in the period incurred. Most common ones here, SG&A, selling, general, and administrative. It's true for variable and fixed selling, general, and administrative expenses. They hit your income statement in the period incurred, all right? That's true for absorption. That is true for variable costing. Now, what's the difference? Notice fixed manufacturing overhead is a product cost. It's not expensed under absorption costing until the product is sold. But look at variable or direct costing. They changed it. Fixed manufacturing overhead is expensed in the period incurred, not when the product is sold. So this is the only difference between absorption costing and variable costing. And you go, Mike, is that a problem? Well, guess what? This is the reason why variable costing is not GAAP. It violates the matching principle. They are expensing the fixed manufacturing overhead for each of these products that's allocated to each of these products in the period incurred, which might be different than the period sold. And that violates the matching principle. Therefore, it is not GAAP. It's okay for internal reporting, internal statements, but not for public-facing financial statements, okay? That's the only difference between them. So how does that affect us? Well, here's what happens. This is what you have to understand. This one difference between them, when the fixed manufacturing overhead is expensed, whether it's expensed when the products are sold, like absorption costing, or whether it's expensed in the period incurred, like variable costing, is going to affect the net income of a company. So you're gonna have two different net incomes, one under absorption, one under variable. So imagine you're in a situation where a company produces goods, they produce inventory, and they sell everything they produce. Guess what? That would mean there's no change. See that triangle? That's a delta. There's no delta inventory. There's no change in inventory. That delta, that triangle, means a change. There's no change in inventory. So this is the easy situation. Absorption net income equals variable net income. Why? Because the inventory level did not change. But look at the next example. What if you produce more goods than you sell? If you produce more goods than you sell, what happens to your inventory? Does it go up or go down? It goes up. Inventory increases. So if inventory increases, absorption net income is going to be greater than variable net income. Why? Well, basically, because the fixed overhead for each of these products that's not sold yet lives on the balance sheet under inventory as an asset. It's not expensed under absorption method. So that means there's less deductions, less expenses for absorption, but it is expensed immediately when incurred when these goods are produced for variable. So variable net income is lower because there's a greater expense. They're expensing it in the period produced, not waiting until it's sold. All right, that's key. So your absorption net income here is greater than your variable net income. What if you sell more goods than you produce? Well, if you sell more goods than you produce, what happens to your inventory? Does it go up or go down? It goes down, okay? It goes down. So that means your absorption net income is going to be less than your variable net income. Why? Well, because the fixed overhead that was living on your balance sheet when you produced these goods, call it 3 quarters ago, you sell them now, you now have to expense all of that fixed overhead that was sitting on your balance sheet for all these goods you produced in earlier periods, right? Matching principle. So now you have a greater expense for cost of goods sold for absorption net income than you do for variable net income. That's why your absorption net income is less than your variable net income. They could ask you the difference in calculating the net income between absorption costing and variable costing. The difference between them is only going to be this equation. It's this simple. The delta units, the change in units, multiplied by the fixed cost per unit, right? FCU is fixed cost per unit. So I'm going to do this multiple choice question with you right now, and then I'm going to do a second one on this where we actually have to calculate the delta in the net income between a variable costing and absorption costing, okay? All right, so now back to this question. They want to know a comparison of absorption versus direct costing methods. Choice A says no difference in net income since all expenses are accounted for regardless of the method. That, my friends, is not true. There is a difference based on what happens to inventory levels, okay? So this is not a good answer. Letter B, there will be greater net income under absorption costing when production equals sales. No, that's scenario number one. That's when there's no change in inventory, when production equals sales. Here, absorption net income will equal variable net income. So it's not greater, it would be the same. So this is not a true statement and not a good answer. Letter C, greater net income under absorption costing when production exceeds sales and inventory amounts increase. That's number two. If we produce more than we sell, inventory increases, and what happens? Absorption net income is greater than variable net income. Yes, this is correct. Why? Because that fixed overhead cost remains on the balance sheet until the goods are sold for absorption. It is not deducted. Therefore, it's going to have a higher net income than variable, because under variable, you deduct that fixed income or fixed overhead, even though you did not sell the goods. All right. So this, my friend, choice C is our correct answer. Letter D, greater net income under direct costing when production exceeds sales. This is also number two, but no, it would be less net income. All right, less than the net income would be lower for direct costing than for absorption. So this, as written, is an incorrect statement. So the only correct statement, choice C. Now, what I want to do in the next question, I want to figure out if they ask us, what's the difference in net income between absorption costing and variable costing. So let's do that. Last sentence first, because it's a long question. How much lower would Duke's net income for year one have been if it had used variable costing instead of absorption costing? Okay, good question. Let's read the facts. In year one, its first year of operations, Duke Manufacturing incurred the following costs when it produced 200,000 units and sold 160,000 units of its only product, Blue. So it produced 200,000 and it produced 200,000 and it sold 160. So how many are left over? Do the math, really easy. If we produce 200,000, which is greater than 160, the difference, 40,000. So since the production was greater than the sales, the delta, the change in the inventory, is going to be a positive 4,000 units. Therefore, the inventory is increasing. So now what happens next? We're in scenario number two that I just highlighted in the lower right corner. Inventory increases, so we know the absorption net income is going to be greater than the variable net income because of this fixed overhead that is not deducted under absorption net income. So how do we do this? Well, we take the manufacturing cost, but only the fixed, not the variable. You see those other three lines, variable 320,000, SG&A 180, variable 80. Those are all distractors, meaningless information. The only number we need here is this 360,000, the fixed manufacturing cost, because that's the only difference between absorption costing and variable costing, just the fixed overhead. That's it. So the fixed overhead is 360,000. We produce 200,000 units. So now we have to allocate this overhead to those 200,000 units. How do we do that? To figure out the fixed cost per unit, you merely take your total fixed overhead, divide it by your units produced, where we get 360,000 overhead divided by 200,000 units produced, comes out to $1.80 for each unit we produced as a fixed cost per unit, or fixed overhead, cost per unit, all right, for our overhead. Now, notice in parentheses, this is the key. This $1.80 is not expensed under absorption costing for those 40,000 units that have not been sold. It is expensed for variable costing, but it is not expensed for absorption costing. And that, my friends, is the difference between the net income between absorption and direct or variable costing method. So difference right here is your delta units times your fixed cost per unit, which is going to be your 40,000 units multiplied by that $1.80 fixed cost per unit. And that comes out to $72,000. So that $72,000, my friends, is the difference in the net income between absorption and variable costing. Not very difficult. Keep this in mind. That $72,000 is living on your balance sheet as an asset under your inventory, and it is not hitting your income statement for absorption costing. However, under variable costing, that $72,000 would be immediately expensed on the income statement and incurred when produced, not when sold. Therefore, it violates a matching principle, and that's why variable costing is not GAAP. Okay? All right. Whew, that was a lot. That sure was. I'm a little tired. Are you tired? I need a break. You need a break? I need a break. Let's take it's about 7 minutes after the hour. Let's take about 5 minutes, come back about 12 or 13 minutes after the hour, and we'll pick up where we left off. Angie Jones in the background, can you give me a little shout out? Everything going well? You hear me? You see me? Everything good?
Everything is great.
Let me know if there's any questions, if the TAs have any questions on anything, the items that they did not address and they want me to address. I could address them before we hit the task-based simulations.
We do have several people asking if your slides with the answers can be shared. If that is okay with you, I will share them out.
That's a great question, right? Let's see. Should we share them? Should we not? What do you think, Angie? Should we share them?
I'm going to share
them. I think it would be very helpful, but not yet. Not yet. We're sharing them not until this is over, because I want to make sure you get all the answers and I give you the most accurate one. So we will email them to you, but we're going to do that after this is over. And the reason I gave you just the blank decks and not with the answers, I'd rather you write the answers down. I'll still send it to you, but when you write this stuff down, a lot of times it sticks up here in your head. So continue to take notes if you've been doing that. Yes, we'll share the answers with you. I have no problem doing that, but I love the fact when you write it down, it helps you remember, okay? All right, so I'll see you in a few minutes. And Angie, if there's any other questions, just let me know when I come back and I can start with those, okay?
Will do, thank you.
Not bad. Not bad. Almost done. Almost done, right? A little bit more. Let's see. Ooh, only two left. Look at that. Only two left. Wow, look at that. Look at that. All right. Just enough break time to solve the Rubik's Cube. How do you like that? All right. Angie, we ready to roll? You back with me?
I'm back and we're ready to go.
You ready to go? All right. Anybody, was there a lot of snoring on your end? Do you hear a lot of people snoring?
No, they're asking a lot of great questions.
All right, that's great. Anybody complaining about the shine off my big bald head? Has that blinded anybody?
Only a couple.
Okay. That's good. That's good. I don't want to be sued for blindness because of my shine off my head. Let's do some task-based simulations. Here's simulation number one. All right. They tell us that Jenny Sanders is a production manager for Brinkline, and they ask her to draft a memo for Bob Johnson, her boss, to give the division's operations manager. The memo is designed to set the framework for analysis and ultimately a decision on whether to, continue or make the Brinkline. All right. Bye. Or make. So they want to say, should we continue to make it or should we accept an offer to buy the product from another company? What do we call these questions? Marginal analysis, right? One type of marginal analysis is, hey, should we produce a good ourselves or should we buy it from a third party? Well, what's the decision based on? Cost. Could we make it for less money or could we buy it for less money? It's that simple. So first question says, using marginal analysis, what is the projected cost per unit to make the Brink product in year 6? So now they're saying, forget about buying it right now. Just tell me, if you make it yourself, how much is it going to cost you per unit? And that's the key, per unit. So to figure out the cost, there are four numbers we need. The direct material cost per unit, the direct labor cost per unit, the fixed overhead cost per unit, and the variable overhead cost per unit. We need those four numbers. So let's go to our exhibit. You see it says resources, and we open up this exhibit. And I'm going to pull up the important information that we need here. Notice it says down at the bottom, we expect to close the fiscal year with 40,000 units sold. All right, so that's the number we're working with this year. All right, then we're going to start with 40,000, and they tell us it's year 5. Then they say, due to increases in demand as a result of robust local economy, we expect a 25% increase in sales in year 6. So you take your year 5 number, 40,000. If there's a 25% increase, you need 25% more. So we multiply by 1.25. The 1 is 100%. I need to make 100% this year of what I made last year, plus an additional 25%. That's where we get the 1.25. So 40,000 times 1.25 is 50,000 units. Now, I'm doing this in the screen in a PowerPoint presentation that I created. If I'm taking the exam now, you know what I'm doing this in? The Excel spreadsheet they provide, spread JS. It looks exactly like Excel. That's the best way to do this because you could quickly type up, 40,000 units, 1.25, put in the next cell formula, equals the cell that contains 40,000, then your asterisk, your times, the cell that contains 1.25 and get your 50. So I suggest when you're doing the homework and you're practicing, use that spreadsheet. It's a quick way to do this and have all the numbers right in front of you. Okay, what next? Then what we're going to have to do is figure out for these 50,000 units, what it is going to cost us to produce it, right? What's our cost per unit? So we're going to start with the total cost and then divide the total cost by 50,000 because that's the number of units we have to produce to create our cost per unit. Okay, so that's where the 50,000 comes from, all right? 40,000 times 1.25. Now, next thing up, what we need to do is
get all of our material. So we have our material and they tell us the material costs $35,000, all right? So I take that $35,000 and I divide it by 50,000 and I get 0.7, all right? So my total direct material cost is going to be $35,000 and I divide it by 50,000, I get a material cost per unit of 0.7. Then they tell us hourly wages for the workers are going to be $8 an hour, and it's going to take about a half hour to produce each unit. So I do the math on that, 50,000 units multiplied by a half hour per unit, multiplied by $8 per hour for the labor, and we get 200,000. So I put in that 200,000 direct labor, and I divide it by the 50,000, and I get $4. Then they tell us next, we have fixed overhead and variable overhead. Our fixed overhead is 280,000. Now here's the pitfall. This is where people go wrong in this question. They use that 280,000. But when we're making a decision whether to make or buy, the key, the only part of the fixed overhead we're interested in is the avoidable portion. Meaning, what's my overhead if I make it myself? And what's my new fixed overhead if I buy it from someone else? And notice they kind of bury it down here. We know we would be able to cut the fixed costs mentioned above by 30% if we were to buy. That, my friends, is the key. So this is the avoidable fixed cost, 30%. So we're only interested in this calculation with that amount, 30%. Of 280,000. The other 70%, we're gonna have regardless of whether we make or buy. Since we're gonna have that other 70%, regardless of whether we make or buy, it does not come into the calculation. That's the key for the marginal analysis, all right? So you take that 280,000, you multiply it by 30%, which is 84,000. So I only am going to use this 84,000 in my equation, the 30% of that. The other 196,000, right? If I took 70% of 280, it would be 196,000. I pay that 196,000 in fixed overhead, whether I buy or whether I make. So we don't worry about that. I only use the 84,000. That's the key. Then finally, our variable overhead cost, 180,000. Well, I'm not going to have that if I don't manufacture. See, what's going to happen if we buy? We don't have the direct material cost. We don't have the direct labor cost. We don't have 30% of the overhead, and we don't have 100% of the variable overhead, right? We don't have 30% of the fixed overhead, and we don't have 100% of the variable overhead. So all of these numbers we can avoid. So if I add it all up, notice what we get, $9.98. That's basically what it's going to cost us to make, because that's all avoidable if we buy from someone else. All right, that's the avoidable portion. So that, my friends, is the answer to the first question. $9.98 is what it would cost us to produce this when we compare it to if we have to buy it from someone else. Second question, in order to make or buy, in order to make the make or buy decision cost neutral. In other words, cost neutral means it's the same cost whether we make or buy. It'll be exactly the same. That's what they're asking here. It says the amount of the fixed cost that would have to be avoidable will be closest to what? So right now in the previous example, they told us 30% of the fixed cost is avoidable, 84,000. Now they're saying, forget that. How much would you have to avoid to come to a break-even point, whether you make or whether you sell? How much of the fixed cost should be avoidable? So it sounds confusing, but when I show you the math, you're gonna be like, oh, that's not so bad. So here's what we're gonna do. How much is it going to cost us to buy this? $9.10 a unit. That's what they give us if we want to go to an outside party, a third-party vendor, and buy it. We could buy it for $9.10, all right? So here's what we're going to do. To buy 50,000 units from this vendor, how much would it cost? 50,000 times $9.10. Do the math. Comes out to $45,000 total. So if I say, forget making it, I'm going to go out, I'm going to buy it for $9.10, we're going to have to spend $455,000, right? $455,000. I might have said $45,000. My eyes are getting a little blurry. $455,000, all right? Now, see what I highlighted in yellow? Those go away if we buy from someone else, right? Those go away. But if we make it ourselves, we have to pay this, okay? So to produce 50,000 units, I have to have $35,000 in direct material. I have to have $200,000 in direct labor. I have to have $180,000 in variable overhead. So that is $415,000 without considering any fixed overhead costs. All right, that's how much it would cost me. So if I take the difference between these, the $455,000 I'll spend buying these units, these 50,000 units, minus the costs I know that I will avoid without considering fixed overhead, the difference is $40,000. So if we could avoid $40,000 in fixed costs, it would be the same thing for us to make it or to buy it. All right. That's our break-even point, right? If we avoid more than $40,000, we're gonna buy it. If we avoid less than $40,000, we're gonna make it because it'll be less money for us to make. So that $40,000 is the distinguisher, the differentiator, it's the line. If I'm above avoiding more than that, I'm going to buy it. If I avoid less than $40,000, I'm going to make it. Okay? So that $40,000 is what they were asking in this question. Let's move on to the next one. Part two. Assuming all costs remain as projected, right? All the information they gave us, will the company choose to make or buy? Well, that's an easy one. We already did it. What was the cost to buy? $9.10. That's given. What's the cost if we make it based on the avoidable fixed cost of 30%? $9.98. So $9.10 is not hard. $9.10 is less than $9.98. So of course we're going to buy. I want to get the least amount of money. $9.10 to buy is less than money than $9.98 to make. Therefore, we would buy in this scenario. So now they say, okay, let's see how good you are. How about in the next question? What if Sanders is able to cut variable overhead cost by 10%. Well, if they do that, see what our original numbers were here. I copy and pasted the table right below, and in Excel, you'd be able to do the same thing. If you had that table created, you can highlight it, copy it, and paste it right below. And the original overhead, variable overhead they gave us was 180, but they're saying we're going to cut it by 10%. If we're going to cut it by 10%, how much of that 180,000 are we still going to incur? 90%, right? If we cut it by 10%, it means we only incur 90%. So I take that 180,000, I multiply it by 90%, and it gives me a new variable overhead number of $162,000. You go, oh, Mike, I see what you're doing here. You're leaving all the numbers the same. You're just changing these numbers that they give you in row three. That's right. Okay. It's the fastest way to do it. Now, it says, oh, you know what we can also cut? We could cut direct labor costs by 15%. So you go to your direct labor cost of 200,000. If we cut it by 15%, how much do we still incur? 85%, right? 100 minus 15 is 85. So we still incur 85%. Therefore, 200,000 times 85%, $170,000, okay? So now, if we do this, look at our new unit cost. We have to buy it for $9.10, but when, again, our spreadsheet will automatically do the math for us. All we had to do was change those two numbers, change the variable overhead and change the direct labor, and it would automatically, if you did it in a spreadsheet, come up with $9.02. That's why using the spreadsheet in these types of questions saves you a lot of time, all right? So what would you rather spend on something? Would you rather buy something for $9.10 or $9.02? Well, if I'm buying 50,000 of them, I want them for the cheapest price. So what's the cheapest price? $9.02. So in this situation, we would make as opposed to buy. Okay? All right. Now, third part. It says, will Sanders' concern about potential rising material prices impact their decision to make or buy? This is an easy question too. If you apply a little common sense, you think about it. Right now, the price to make it is $9.98. And that price is already higher than the $9.10 to buy, right? So if material prices go up, that $9.98 would go up as well. It would push it higher. And if I'm locked in at $9.10 and I know the material costs are coming up, I want to spend $9.10, not more than $9.98. So our decision to make or buy is going to remain unchanged. We're still going to buy because it's going to be the best deal for us, especially if prices are going up, right? So it would have no impact on our decision. So if I click this little blue button and it pulls up this little box for me, I would highlight no impact and put that in as my answer. Okay? So that's a great little task-based simulation on this types of marginal analysis. All right, so I want to go over that with you. I hope you found that one useful. Now what we're going to do is we're going to move over to our next scenario. So I just need to jump to my next deck. All right, here we go. Well, I think I earned a drink of water here. Were you impressed by my Rubik's Cube? I consider that my superpower, solve a Rubik's Cube in about 2 minutes. What do you think? Yeah, I'm a geek. I'm a nerd. I get it. I'm in accounting. I used to do computers, all right? Don't hold it against me. Don't hold it against me. Brings me joy, all right? It brings me joy. All right, you know what else brings me joy? Helping people pass BEC. And that's you. Yes, you, that you're listening to me. You're going to pass. Let's do this next one. Aleo Inc. is concerned that although a company's profits have increased significantly over past 3 years, hey, that's good. Uh-oh, cash balance has declined. That's always a problem for businesses. You look successful on paper, but if you're not collecting fast enough and you don't have enough cash, that's a big problem, okay? Cash is king. You need a good, strong statement of cash flows, okay? So they say, using the information in the exhibits, complete these two tables. And they say in the first table, calculate the required financial metrics for year 5 and year 6. All right, so we're doing it for 2 years. Round the time periods to the nearest day and the other metrics to 2 decimals. No problem. And they're giving us about 5 calculations, days in inventory, days in sales for receivables, payables, cash conversion, and quick ratio. No problem. We got this. Then for part 2, they say, hey, we want to know an explanation for the possible outcome for the changes in these metrics from year 5 to year 6. So now they're asking for interpretation. Uh-oh, did the metric go up or down from year 5 to year 6? And why would that happen? What does that mean? Okay, so we're going to have to use the exhibit of the analytics definitions for these ratios. So they didn't ask you to memorize them, so that's a good thing. And then fill in this table. So let's do it. Okay, I'm going to zoom in on this first table, and now I'm going to just show you the first row. This is the only row we have to focus on one at a time. Okay, so we have to figure out days in inventory for year 6 and for year 5. So let's pull up our financial statement extracts, and here's what they give us. They give us a portion of the income statement and the balance sheet. I'm going to, for space, it's going to make it easier for me if I put them instead of vertically, side by side. So I'm going to take the income statement portion, move it down, and have the balance sheet right next to it. Okay, so you see my income statement on the left and my balance sheet on the right. Okay, so now we have to calculate days in inventory, or we could also call inventory turnover days for year 6, then for year 5. So here's our formula right from our analytics definitions. If you pulled up the analytics definition, here's the way you calculate it. You take your ending inventory and you divide it by the ratio of the cost of goods sold over 365 days. So if I go to my inventory, I see in my balance sheet, of course, because it's an asset. And then on my income statement, I see my cost of goods sold or cost of sales. All right. So now what we're going to do is take these numbers for year 6. My ending inventory is 3,000 units divided by my cost of sales, $9,300 divided by 365 gives me 118 days. That's it. So I take that 118 days. That's not so bad. Then I do the same thing for year 5. I take my year 5 ending inventory, divide that by my year 5 cost of sales, divided by 365, and we get 72 days. And notice our days in inventory, what's happening. In year 5, it was only sitting in inventory 72 days, but units are now sitting in inventory a lot longer, 118 days. They're going to ask us why. All right, so that's a question in part 2 we have to answer why. Forget it for now. We're coming back to these numbers. Okay. Now let's go to the next one, days sales and accounts receivable. We pull up our analytics definitions and we see that it's going to be the ending receivables divided by the ratio of the net sales over 365. So here are my receivables on my balance sheet. Here are my net sales, my revenue, and I plug in my numbers. For year 6, 3,800 receivables divided by 15,600 in revenue divided by 365, and we get 89 days, all right? Our days in accounts receivable, 89 days. So I plug that in. Now we do the same exact thing for year 5. So I take my receivables ending year 5, 1850, divided by my revenue for year 5, 11,100, divided by 365, and we get 61 days. So notice what's happening here. Our days in receivable used to be 61 days, but uh-oh, now receivables are living 89 days, so it's increasing there as well. Why would that happen? We're going to have to answer that question. Let's go to the next one. I only need this little portion of my income statement and balance sheet, so to give myself more room, I truncated it. So what we want to do now is calculate days of payables outstanding. So the formula on our analytics definition is our ending payables divided by the ratio of the cost of goods sold over 365. So I look for my payables and I look for my cost of sales and I take that and I plug in for the ending year six payables of 2870 divided by my cost of sales for year six, 9300 divided by 365, and I get 113 days. I take that, I plug it in. Not hard math, right? Just picking out the numbers, plugging them in, doing the math, and writing down your answer. Then for year five, same thing. I take my payables for the end of the year of year five, 1600, divided by the 6600 cost of sales, divide that by the 365, and we get 88 days. So now notice our payables. We used to make our payables in 88 days. Now it's 113 days, so that's increased as well. I wonder why that's happening. Guess what? They're going to ask us. Okay. Now, cash conversion cycle, that's an easy one. What's that? Very simple. All you do is you add up your days in inventory plus your days in sales and you subtract your days of payables outstanding. That's your cash conversion cycle, okay? So it's real simple. What we would do for year six is take the 118 inventory, then we would add the 89 days for the receivables, subtract out the 113 for payables, get 94 days and plug that in. Can't ask for simpler math than that. Do the same thing for year five. We would take the 72 days in inventory, then we would add the 61 days for receivables, subtract out the 88 days for payables, and we get 45 days, okay? So the cash conversion cycle, you say, oh, come on, give me that one. I got that one in the bank. That's an easy one. I won't mess that one up. Then you have your quick ratio. Now, your quick ratio, I want you to be aware of, they can also call it your acid test, your quick ratio, means the same thing. See the income statement in the balance sheet? Guess what? You don't need the income statement. This is the only one. It's only balance sheet, okay? That's it. Only balance sheet. So what is our quick ratio, our acid test? It is going to be your cash plus your cash equivalents plus your marketable securities plus your receivables, right? Those are all things that are readily cash divided, all, add them all together, divide them all by your current liabilities, right? And that's your quick ratio. So notice we have cash, 120. We don't have cash equivalents given. We don't have marketable securities given. So they're all zeros. And then we have our receivables, 3,800. Add that up, then you divide that by your current liabilities of 3,870, and you get your quick ratio 1.01. Now, before we put that in our answer sheet, let's do the same thing for year five. For year five, we have our cash of 900. Again, no cash equivalents, no marketable securities. We do have receivables of 1850. Add it all up, divide it by our current liabilities of 1750, and we get 1.57. So I have to take that 1.01, the 1.57, take those numbers and add them both to our answer sheet. And my friends, we are done part one. Okay, next one. Let's go to part two. Change in days in inventory. So they want to know, what's the explanation for the change in days of inventory? Well, I'll just pull the numbers for you. Year five was 72 days. Year six was 118. We calculated that in the previous part. So why is there a 46-day increase in our inventory, right? It's taking us longer to sell inventory, 46 days longer. You want to sell your inventory fast, right? That the faster you sell it, the better. So adding an extra 46 days, what's that all about? Well, let's go to a transcript of a management discussion is one of our exhibits or a management meeting. So you have to now read through this. And this is where they get you on the exam because they know it takes you time to read through this. But what I'm looking for now, any information that affects inventory levels. So if I scan through this, I look for inventory levels, top half, I don't see it. I don't see anything here. So now I'm going to scroll down to the bottom half of this. If I scroll to the bottom half, what do I see? Oh, I see. Sophia says to Mick Ryan, hey, to be fair, the same supplier introduced a bulk purchase scheme where we get a lower price if we order larger quantities. So they're trying to save money by buying a larger amount of inventory up front. They're giving us more favorable pricing. So if we're paying less, that's good, but we're getting a lot more inventory, right? So what that basically means is as we purchase more inventory, purchase it in larger quantities, it makes sense that our days in inventory is going to increase because now we have a lot more inventory that we need to sell, okay? So now with that in the back of our mind, let's look at the answers they give us in the answer choice. So if I click on this blue button, here are all of the things. So what I need to do is read through this list and try to find something about, you know, buying in bulk to save money. As I go through it, I see, oh, accepting suppliers bulk purchase discounts. Yeah, we're buying a lot more inventory up front, but we're saving money. It's just taking us longer to sell the inventory. So that, my friends, makes sense and explains what's happening over here. So I plugged in accepting suppliers bulk purchase discounts. Now let's move on to the next one. Change in day sales and accounts receivable. Okay. Well, it says here that our days sales and accounts receivable for year 5 was 61 days, but year 6 it was 89 days. So there's a 28-day increase. Why? Why is it taking us 28 days longer to collect from our customers? There's got to be a reason why. So let's go back to our transcript of the management meeting. And if I look for anything related to accounts receivable, I don't see in the top half. So I need to scroll to the bottom half. And if I do, hey, look at what Patricia tells us. She says, well, we've been under great pressure to help a firm's sales drive, so we've offered some generous credit terms to attract business away from our competitors. Oh, that makes sense. Giving generous terms means we're giving them more time to pay. Hey, instead of having to pay us in 30 days or 45 days, take 60 days, take 90 days. We're getting more business, but it's taking us longer to collect. That's the problem here. So if I pull up my answers, what I'm looking for is I'm looking for giving more favorable trade terms. So if I go down this list, I see towards the bottom, oh yeah, relaxing the trade terms, meaning giving them more time to pay to generate new business, okay? So I take that and I plug that in. Last item for this one, change in days of payables outstanding. All right. So if we take a look at this, we had under year 5, our payables were outstanding 88 days. Now our payables were taking a lot longer to pay, 113 days, which doesn't really bother me that much if it doesn't hurt our credit or we're not violating the terms of any agreements. I'd rather hold my money longer and pay it. But why? What's the reason that it's happening? That's what they want to ask us. Why? Why did our payables increase by 25 days? We need to know. So again, let's go back to the transcript of the management meeting. I don't see anything on this first page about accounts payable. It's just all filler information. Then if I go down to the second half of this, I see from again, Sophia, she says, our main supplier cut the discount for quick payment from 2% to 0.5%. You know how we have like 210 net 30? Hey, I'll give you a 2% discount if you pay me within 10 days. Otherwise, pay me within 30 days. They just cut it from 2% to 0.5%. To heck with 0.5%. I don't care about 0.5% discount. I'd rather keep my cash longer for just 0.5% discount. So it says you can imagine our response to that. Yeah, I can imagine it. They're like, screw you. I'm not paying you for only 0.5%. I'm not paying you sooner. I'm going to hold my money longer. So it says, especially we've been under pressure to conserve cash. So what we're saying here is if our discount is cut from 2% to 0.5%, there's no incentive for me to pay early. I'm going to hold my money. That's why the payables are outstanding longer. So if we pull up all of our choices, I'm looking for something related to them cutting our discounts for quick payments. And I see the third choice, rejecting suppliers' quick payment discounts. Yeah, they went from 2% to 0.5%. Forget that. I'm not going to do that. And we plug that in. And that, my friends, is the answer to everything in part 2. All right. How's that feel? You need a little stretch. Sometimes I need a little stretch. I go through all of this stuff. These are the answers to this entire scenario. I feel like we've accomplished a lot. We're still not done yet, though. You know why? We need to talk about written communications. Then we need to talk about timing on the exam. So stay with me. Don't go anywhere. All right. Let me get to my next one, which is around here. It is written communications. Now, we know written communications are a big portion. There's three of them on the exam. So what you need to know about written communication are a few things. And if you're a Becker student, if you've seen some of my skill builder videos on this, you've seen this already, but I cannot emphasize this enough. If there's anybody that's not in Becker, I don't know if people have told you this, but if you want to get full credit for a written communication, here's what you need to know. Always read the question twice before you answer. Why? The first time you read it is for a general understanding. The second time is a more detailed reading. You're kind of getting straight what facts that they're giving you and what they're asking you, all right? Then, when you start to write your answer, please understand what they're grading you on. They are not grading you on the accuracy of your content, whether you answered the question correctly. They are grading you on spelling, grammar, punctuation, your ability to write, complete sentences, paragraph format. Never use a bulleted list. Never use a numbered list. They will give you no credit for that, okay? Do not use an abbreviation unless you first define that abbreviation. For example, if you want to say something about the SEC, you can't write SEC, all right? That could be the Southeast Conference. Maybe you're a college football fan. You're trying to check out what, you know, Alabama's doing against, Auburn, right? That's SEC too. SEC is Securities Exchange Commission. So you write out Securities Exchange Commission, you put SEC in parentheses, then you can refer to SEC all the time after that, all right? So please make sure you understand they're assessing your ability to write and your grammar and your spelling and your punctuation, not the accuracy of your answer, okay? If you answered something about, you know, that was totally way off about some, you know, aliens invading the earth, then maybe that could be a problem, right? But as long as you come with a thoughtful, concise, well-articulated and organized answer, even if the content is not right, they're not going to take off the credit for that, all right? They're looking at what I just highlighted. The next thing you need to be aware of, the order that you answer, how you answer, how you write, this is what you must follow. IEC. This is the key to the structure of your answer. You always start out with a little one or two sentence introduction and the issue, the reason why you're writing this. Then you give an explanation. Now, an explanation paragraph is where you apply whatever rule or regulation or law to the facts given to you and you explain what's happening. Now, an explanation paragraph could be one paragraph, could be two, three, four, five. It depends on the question that they ask. So your how many explanation paragraphs you write varies based on the question. Then you must end with a conclusion. Your conclusion must answer the issue and you must draw a conclusion based on the explanations you provided, all right? That's the well-organized answer where they see that you stated an issue, you gave some explanatory information, and you drew a valid conclusion, and then you give a valid closing, all right? So IEC. Let's just do an example. I pulled up one of our many written communication questions, and it says, the Rupa Corporation's preparing an annual audit. The CFO is developing a risk assessment. And I picked risk assessment because we talked about this in, I think, our very first multiple choice question, right? On internal control, on the CRIME acronym, on risk assessment. And it relates to the objective of reliable financial reporting that you need to present to your auditors. So they're asking you to identify and analyze the risks of material misstatements. They've asked you to get help from the controller and basically perform this risk evaluation using the principles of risk assessment from COSO, right? COSO, it always shows up in some way, shape, or form. The CRIME acronym, the Integrated Control Framework, Internal Control Integrated Framework, okay? And there are three they specifically call out that you would need to address. They ask you to include a discussion on financial reporting objectives, financial reporting risks, and fraud risks. So I see right there, three paragraphs. Now, each paragraph just needs to be two or three sentences. That's it. They just want you to make sure that you address financial reporting objectives, that you address financial reporting risk, that you address fraud risk. And then they tell you a controller does not have public accounting experience, is not familiar with this framework. So they need your written communication to the controller explaining the issues associated with these principles that will serve as the basis for the risk assessment. All right. That's it. So they're talking about risk assessment, specifically these three items. So now I go to my answer sheet. What I do on my answer sheet, I make sure, again, you could do it on your little Mylar that you have right next to your computer if you're not writing, obviously, on the computer screen. And I jot down, I need to remember to address financial reporting objectives, financial reporting risks, and fraud risks. So I know I need to address those. Then I put out my outline, my IEC. I need an intro, I need an issue, I need explanations, conclusions, and closing. And I start out almost in like a little outline format where I just say, all right, here's a nice little intro. We need to formalize our risk assessment strategy associated with financial reporting for the upcoming audit. I pulled that right out of the question. I'm regurgitating information they gave me. Issue, we will be using COSO's internal control integrated framework to analyze and document our risk assessment. I pulled that right out of the question. All right. Now I go to my explanation. I had a little extra line here and I address those three issues. I tell them the three issues I'm going to address. All right. My financial reporting objectives, financial reporting risk, and my fraud risk. Then I have a paragraph for each one. My financial reporting objectives. I talk about stating fairly our financial performance in accordance with GAAP. We only present information in our financial statements that's both relevant and material. And reporting objectives need to be supported by our relevant assertions as described under GAAP. So I kind of give whatever information that I know related to financial reporting objectives. And again, this is a model answer. You don't need to have a model answer to get full credit. Believe me, all right? I'm just showing you a model answer right now. Second paragraph for explanations. Now I have to address financial reporting risk. And that's basically going to be a risk. Our financial statements are not presented in conformity with GAAP, right? Big problem. So we have to document procedures and processes, all of our technology infrastructure, because we have to substantiate how we prepared these financial statements. And we have to identify probability and severity of risks and how we plan to respond to those risks. Finally, number three, give a couple sentences on fraud risk. Represents a potential for material misstatement and maybe an employee's intent to deceive. And we have to document maybe any incentives, pressures, opportunities, or even rationalizations, which could lead someone to materially misstate information. And we also have to identify and how we could prevent fraud and stop unauthorized control overrides, as well as what technology we could run to detect fraud. Okay. So just a couple of sentences on each one. And again, this is a model answer. So it's not like you have to hit every single point, but if you lay it out in this format, it's going to tremendously help you towards getting full points. Okay. Then conclusion. We need to expand the internal control narratives and flowcharts that we provide to the auditors to make sure we address our objectives as well as risks of not achieving those objectives. And then a closing, we need to get started as soon as possible. Please let me know your availability. I'd love to meet and discuss it in more detail. Anything like that. So now I would never submit my answer looking like this. Why? Because it's an outline format. All I do at this point now, if you write it out first in an outline format the way that I did, I have to delete out outline, intro, issue, make sure it's all in paragraph format. So I take this exact answer and I just move it to a paragraph format just like this. Boom. Full credit. Okay. And you can get it too. And make sure you follow those little IEC outline and all those other little points that I brought to your attention. Okay. All right. Now, let's talk about having a plan on how much time to spend on each and every question. And this is key because so many students come up to me or they email me or ping me and they're like, Mike, you know, I was rocking and rolling. I was doing well, but I ran out of time. I didn't get to the last written communication. Or I didn't get to the last two written communications and I got a 72 and I know I would have passed. I'm like, oh no, you fell off your timing plan. You must have a timing plan. Okay. All right, so I'm laying out the exam for you right now, okay? So the exam is 4 hours. You see that in the top center, 4 hours, and then there's a 15-minute allowable break, but you have 4 hours of exam time. That, if you multiply it by 60, means you have 240 minutes for the test, okay? Now, what'll happen is you'll sit down for the first couple of minutes. They give you a little welcome launch code. You put in your NTS launch code. You read over the confidentiality agreements, you sign the oath, I will not disclose any information, you do all of that. Make sure you don't run out of time doing that, otherwise the exam closes, you can't take it. So you have 5 minutes, which is more than enough time, it takes 30 seconds, okay? But just watch your time. All right, now we're ready to begin, okay? We're ready to begin testlet number one. It's made up of 31 multiple choice questions. I recommend bottom of the screen, you see where it says 31 questions for BEC in the first testlet, I recommend 50 minutes for this testlet. Try not to spend more than 50 minutes in. That gives you a little over a minute and a half a question. And that's on average. Some questions are going to take you 3 or 4 minutes. Some are going to take you 10 seconds. But on average, you have a minute and a half, a little over a minute and a half. So that means you have 50 minutes. So when you start this, you have 4 hours remaining. It'll tell you 4 hours remaining. Then when you finish this, when you click, you know, submit and move on to the next one, at that point, you should have at least 3 hours and 10 minutes remaining, all right? Should tell you 3 hours and 10 minutes remaining. Don't waste more than that, because if it takes you more time than that, you're going to start to run out of time for your other testlets. They're also going to give you an option to take a break. They say, hey, do you have an emergency? Do you need to go to the bathroom? Answer is no. I don't care. Don't do it. Why? Because that clock keeps running. If you run out to go to the bathroom and come back, it's going to really significantly impede your ability to pass this exam. You go, but Mike, what if I have an emergency? Go to the bathroom before you sit for the exam, all right? Come on, go before you sit. You could get through about 2 hours or so without having to go to the bathroom, all right? So now what you do is you immediately say, no thanks, I don't want to take a break. I'm going to go to the second testlet, okay? Again, another 31 multiple choice questions. Give yourself another 50 minutes. That, again, is about a minute and a half, minute, 1.6 minutes a question. So when you start, you should be at the 3 hour, 10 minute mark. When you finish, when you're all done and you submit, you should at least have 2 hours and 20 minutes remaining, okay? Then they're going to say, hey, you sure you don't want to take a break? Do not take a break because the clock keeps running. No, I don't want to take a break yet. Okay, I'm not ready for a break. Hold it in, all right? Don't lose that precious time. And then you're ready to begin your first testlet for TBSs, the third testlet overall. And there are two task-based simulations. Give yourself 40 minutes for those, okay? 20 minutes per task-based simulation. So when you start, you're at the 2 hour, 20 minutes remaining mark. When you're done, you submit this, you should have at least 1 hour and 40 minutes left. Then they say, hey, do you want to take a break? Yes, you take a break here. Now you go to the bathroom. Now you get a drink of water. Why? The clock stops running for 15 minutes, all right? Make sure you're back within 15 minutes. Otherwise, it automatically picks up and starts running again, all right? You can't delay it, all right? They don't wait for you. So it's okay. Don't take a break until the end of the third testlet, all right? Now you have two more task-based simulations. Again, give yourself another 40 minutes for that. And that's 20 minutes per task-based simulation. If you need more than 20 minutes, it's a problem, all right? You're probably not figuring out something. They should be able to be solved in around 20 minutes. If not, you're taking away time from other stuff that you might be able to solve, all right? So you submit what you have and you move on. So you started with 1 hour and 40 minutes remaining. At the end of that, when you submit, you should have 1 hour left, all right? Now, if you have 1 hour left, do you want to take a break? Answer is no, I just took a break. I don't need another break. So you go to your 3 written communication questions, all right? Give yourself 20 minutes for each one. That's a total of 60 minutes, and that will bring you to your full 240 minutes, okay? So you'll start this testlet with an hour remaining. Then when you're done, you should have zero time left on the clock. You complete your survey, and you're like, whew, I did it. Big smile comes on your face because you're like, it was hard, it was grueling, but I was prepared, and I think I did okay, all right? And even if you think you did not do okay, there's a good chance you still pass the exam. Because a lot of people think, oh, I need a 75 pass and there's no way I got 75% correct. Uh-uh, that's not true. You need a 75 to pass, but that is not a percent. It is a scaled score through some metric or algorithm of the AICPA that we have no knowledge of what it is. So you theoretically could get a 60 or 65% on the exam and it scales to a 75 and you pass. I've gotten a lot of students that said, Mike, oh, I didn't know this question. I didn't know that question. There was so much stuff. Remember, 1 out of every 6 multiple choice questions is not graded. 1 of the written communications is not graded. And the same thing could be true for also one of your task-based simulations. So you don't know what is graded, what is not graded, what are test questions that they may use on future exams. You know, there's all sorts of things that you hear people chattering about. I saw this question, I saw that question, I didn't study that. Probably is not being counted on the exam, okay? All right, now, my friends, we are 5 minutes before the 2 hour mark. I told you we're probably gonna be about 2 hours. So I want to thank everyone for participating. And I want, before we break, I want to tell you, you can do this. It is hard work. And you have to put a lot of hours in there. But if you get through this and you pass all four of these sections and you get those three beautiful letters after your name, CPA, you are going to be so happy you are. It is going to help you so much in your professional career. It is going to establish opportunities for you beyond what you can ever believe. And you'll always be employed. You'll always be making a very good living. And as time progresses and you get experience, you will be shocked at how much money CPAs make. So it will be well worth it for you to go through this. Now, for anyone that has to jump, that's perfectly fine. I'm going to try something that I've never done before. So if you can hang around for a few minutes, I'm going to do a little quiz with you guys. And we're going to do a little competition. And whoever the top three performing people are, we're going to give a $50 gift card for the best performer, a $25 gift card to second and third place. So you say, all right, Mike, how are we going to do this? Well, it's the first time I'm trying it. So let's see. I am going to stop sharing my screen for just a moment because I have to pull up what we're going to use to do this. So let me go and pull this up. And we are going to start. Okay, there we go. Now, I'm going to go back and start sharing my screen again. Angie, let me know in just a second if you can see this. Anybody ever played Kahoot before? It's a fast, easy way. If you have a computer next to you or you have your cell phone, you could either go to kahoot.it and put in this PIN code, or you could use that bar scanner. All right. So what I'd like you to do, are you seeing my screen, Angie?
Yes, it looks great. Yes.
Great. Okay. So you scan with your phone that barcode and join the game. Now, the only thing I'll say is if you put in a real name or a real email address, it's a little bit better so that if you're a winner, I know who you are, right? Because if you put in, like some people put in some numbers and I don't know who you are with numbers. So you could either put in your name, first and last name, or an email address or something so that if you are one of the winners, we could verify that you are, you know, that we give it to the right person, okay? All right, we got lots of people coming in here. I love it, love it, love it. Oh, I'm going to share in just a second again. There we go. I just have to hide that. Okay. All right. All right, I'm going to give everybody some time to join. And if you didn't use your name and you leave and come back in, that's fine. So you put in a real name or an email address or something like that. All right, we got $50 gift card to the winner, and we got $25 to second and third place. So we're going to award $100 in prizes. Angie, I did not get this authorized by the marketing team. You think they're going to get mad at me?
I think you'll be okay. This is a great idea.
All right. Let's say we're at 235. We're at 235. We're going to give just another couple of minutes, just another minute or two. I love Kahoot. I don't know about you, but whoever invented this is like one of the most smartest people ever. I think I said most smartest. You can't say most smartest. That's not good. I don't sound too smart when I say most smartest. All right. We're 275. Let's see. Anybody else coming? Going once. Come on. Give you another 10 seconds if you want to get in. Grab that phone. Scan that barcode. Put in your name. Put in your email address. Put in something. And we're going to start it in about 20 more seconds. Okay. I'm ready. I don't know about you, but I'm ready. We got almost 300 people. All right. Let's do this. I'm going to start this game. All right, let's do a BEC workshop Kahoot. First thing up is going to be a poll. I want you to get a little poll here. I want you to answer your question. All right, was this BEC workshop worth your time? Hit on your phone or on your computer. Let me know. I'm terrible. Put me to sleep. Or it was all right, not too bad. Or hey, I really liked it a lot. All right, so go in there and let me know what you think. Good thing I have thick skin. If I get everybody says not worth it, well, you know, it is what it is, right? But we tried our best here. So hope you had a good time. Hope you learned a lot. All right. So let's see. All right. I got that. Really good. Really good. Well, that's good. And I'm glad it. Now, we always have some detractors. Let me look up who the detractors are in red. Oh, it's my wife. My wife. She didn't like, oh my God, I'm in trouble. All right. All right. Let's go to the next question. Let's go to the next question. Here's another poll question. This is just to get you warmed up. All right. Just to get you warmed up. All right. What do we think about me? That guy, Mike. What do we like? Do we like Mike? We not like Mike. He's okay. He's not bad. He's terrible. He puts me to sleep. You're snoring. You're going to record this and play it if you ever can't fall asleep. You're going to use this broadcast to help you go to sleep. What are you going to do? All right. You get me fired. It's okay. All right. All right. We got a good number of people who liked it. Well, thank you. I'm glad to hear that. We try our best over here. All right. All right. Now we start. Now we're going to have five questions. And if you get the right answer, you're going to get points. But it's also based on speed. First person who answers correctly gets the most points. All right? It's not me. It's a computer that does it. So remember, speed counts. But if you pick a wrong answer, you don't get any points. Right answer, fastest right answer gets the most points. Okay? Let's get ready to go. All right. What's not part of the COSO internal control framework? All right. Most people got it. Most people got it. So 119 got it. Let's see. So that means you're learning. All right. We see who's in the lead. We see who's in the lead. Fatima, Lindsay, Jant. All right. Anika, let's go. All right. Here's the next one. Get ready. Remember, speed counts. Here we go. All right. Do you have to be a CPA to be a financial expert? All right. That's right. Most people remember we went over that when I went over with you. Most people got is false. You do not have to be a CPA to be a financial expert. Excellent. Excellent. All right. Let's get new scores. Oh, Jayant made her move. Look at that. She made a move. And then Haley coming up out of nowhere. We got Ting and Ben and Leah. All right. Good job, everybody. It's close race. It is a close race. All right. Let's see what the third question is. True statement. Pick the true one. What's true? Ooh, that was a tough one. Look at that. That was a tough one. Remember, demand was directly correlated. If demand increases, quantity increases, price increases. They're all directly correlated, okay? The only one that everything was directly correlated was that green choice. All right, let's see. Let's see if there's any more shakers in the order. Let's see. Oh, Nick making his move, jumped up, and Angela Giant is still hanging in there. Haley and Ting are still there as well. All right, but Nick made a big move. Wow, look at that. All right, let's see. We got two more. We got two more. Which item is not a tool available to the Fed to control the money supply? Most people got it. That's right. Taxation. We didn't talk about taxation. We did talk about open market operations, discount rate, and required reserve ratio. Taxation is something under monetary policy by the federal government, nothing to do with the money supply and the Federal Reserve. So good job. All right. Hold your breath. Let's see what's happening. Oh, Nick on fire. Look, Nick, they gave you fire symbol. Wow. All right, but Janth made her move and Ting made in Haley. All right. It's down to this last question. Now, I'm going to give you, for this last question, get paper and pen if you don't have it. I'm going to give you a minute because this next one is going to be a math problem, and you're going to have to do math, all right? So I'm going to give you 60 seconds, but if you have a paper and pencil handy, it's going to be easier to do this last question, okay? So if you don't have it, I'll give you another 30 seconds. Go grab a pen, grab a piece of paper so you're prepared to do a little math. Don't say I did not warn you. All right. Give you another 10 seconds. Give you another 10 seconds. All right. I'm getting ready to do it. Math problem now. You need the right answer, and the faster you do it, the better. Ready? Here we go. Ten seconds. See if anybody got it. See if anybody got it. 11 people got it. Excellent. Now, I'm not going to hit next just yet. I'm going to just go over this problem. See these last two terms? The very last term, 9 raised to the 1/2, is a square root. That's another way to say square root. Square root of 9 is 3. So that's plus 3. See this one? 3 squared is 9. Take the square root of 3 squared, and you're back to 3. And it's a minus 3. So these last two terms cancel out. Minus 3 plus 3. They cancel out. The first part of this, you had to use order of operations, right? Do multiplication and division before addition and subtraction. So I don't do addition first. I do 6 divided by 2 is 3. So that's 6 plus 3 is 9. And then I have to do this multiplication. Negative 3 times 4 is negative 12. So 9 minus 12 is a minus 3. And then I have to add 2 to that is a minus 1. And I just messed it up too. 6 divided by 2 is 3. And 4 and 3 times 2 is negative 12. So we have 3 minus 12 is minus 9. Plus 6 is minus 3. Plus 2 is minus 1. And then we have another minus 1 is minus 2. Plus 6 minus 2 plus 6 is 4. Yes, it does work out. All right, so the answer was 4. Let's see who our winner is going to be. Ha! All right, you backed in for a $25 gift card. Laura, $25 gift card, and our big winner is... BA363, whoever you are, I don't know, but you would win the $50 gift card, all right? I gotta take a screenshot of this and make sure I know who everybody is, and we'll try to work to get you those. All right, everybody, I am going to stop sharing my screen and just say a little bit of a goodbye to you. So let me get right back here. All right, everybody, hope you enjoyed it. Hope you learned a lot. Hope you had a little fun. Hope you found it useful. I wish you the best of luck passing this BEC exam. It takes hard work. Put the time in, do the multiple choice, practice, 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 do the test-based simulations, do the Becker simulated exams. And if you're not a Becker student and you want to pass, we have deep dives, we have a great textbook, we have great problems, we can help you pass. So I wish everybody best of luck on this exam. Please reach out to me, let me know if you have questions, let me know how you did. We love to hear from our students, and I know you will do it. You will pass BEC. You will pass the other three parts of the exam. You will be a CPA, and we want to help you do it. We want to be, we are on your team, and we want to help you become a CPA. So please reach out to us, study hard, best of luck, and I hope to see you in class in the future, everyone. Have a great day, and thanks for coming.